with me. Come on and talk to me. I really wanna know what you think.
I wanna hear your truth. I wanna see what you see. Come on and talk to me. The girl lovely tea in this name and cheese.
Hey everyone, welcome to our third episode of the Green Tea Room with your girl Lovely Tea. Thank you guys so much for joining me tonight. So there's a lot to talk about, and as you guys know, the topic at hand is pretty privilege. Does it exist? And the reason why I'm talking about this is, if you guys do not know, for the past 2 days, rapper Sweetie has been trending because a lot of folks have been going in on her. She performed recently at the iHeartRadio Jingle Bell Fest, and basically her performance was lackluster. People are calling it trash. Folks are dragging her on the internet. She was out of breath. There was really no choreography. When I tell you the DJ was more hyped and put in more work than Sweetie, somebody needs to give that DJ a raise, because she was really putting in work and really hyping up the crowd. Sweetie was just, she just looked a mess. She was just out of breath. She didn't take the choreography seriously. It might be from the whole McDonald's meal situation. Maybe she's eating too much McDonald's, but the way she was moving on that stage just did not look right. And then, of course, when all else fails, what do? You just turn around and sell sex. So she ends up getting down on all four. She clicks her kitten heels together and she starts twerking. So at this point, people were like, you know what? I can't defend this. This is ridiculous. And social media have been basically going in on her and stating that the only reason why Sweetie is getting as far as she's gotten is solely due to pretty privilege. And she's talked about this in the past, where she said things like, you know, pretty privilege has been a disadvantage to her. It hasn't helped her out as much. And I just don't believe that. I feel like she gets chance after chance when it comes to her performances and her freestyles and things like that. She gets chances that the average female rapper does not get. And I feel like she gets those chances based upon her looks. If that was Lizzo up there with that flute, out of breath, dancing like she can't keep up, folks would be dragging her. Folks would be talking about her weight and things like that. So for, you know, Sweetie to be half her size and to not keep up with the performance, that left a bad taste in everybody's mouth. Now, another thing that's causing a lot of controversy as well when it comes to, you know, pretty privilege is Lori Harvey. So if you guys do not know, recently Lori Harvey was casted as one of the judges for the 70th anniversary of the Miss Universe pageant. So all of the other judges that were there, a lot of them have long resumes. Some were lawyers. A lot of them have put in a lot of work in their field to be able to judge. And some of people were confused as to why Lori Harvey was there, besides the fact that she's Steve Harvey's stepdaughter. A lot of people felt like she shouldn't have been up there to judge anything, because even the announcer, the only thing that the announcer could say is that she's an entrepreneur, a model, and she has a skincare line. But then when they read everybody else's accolades, it was so long. So a lot of people felt like the only reason why she's where she's at is because of Steve Harvey and her good looks. So today we're going to have a discussion. I want to hear from you guys. I want to know, what are your thoughts on pretty privilege? So let me go ahead and introduce my co-host, Marinelle. Marinelle, are you there?
Can you hear me?
Hello?
Can you hear me clearly?
Okay, I can hear you now. Okay. Okay, perfect. So I wanted you to go ahead and chime in on everything as far as what you saw and how you feel about the situation with Sweetie and Lori Harvey.
Yeah, the conversation with C and I started 2 days ago, or yesterday night. I messaged C and I was like, look, I know nobody can understand me better than you regarding that topic. And I'm a pageant girl. Like, I love pageant. I participated in pageant. I won pageant. Like, I love pageant. So I watch pageant. So when I was watching Miss Universe, and they like judge number one, and then they list everything she accomplished. Judge number two, she was Miss Universe 2015, and she has this foundation. Judge number three, and then they read judge number four, and I heard Lori Harvey. She is a supermodel, and she has a skincare line. Yay! I'm like, what the hell? And I was so disappointed, and I was telling you about that. I'm like, to win, to judge a Miss Universe, you need certain, you need a certain background. You need to know what you're doing, because you're judging tons of women based on their poise, their education, their elegance. And what has she do to be sitting here judging this woman on whether what they're saying sound intelligent or not, when we basically never heard her speak to know if she's intelligent or not? And it's not even to knock what she's, who she is as a person, because she was able to take that Steve Harvey name and to make a brand for herself. And everybody would love to be able to come from a family that, I'm sorry, if I come from a Jeff Bezos, I'll never work a day in my life. I'm just going to take the Bezos name and I'm just going to drag it and be a millionaire on my own. So it's not even to knock what she's done, but it's still sad as someone who have like, and I know I'm not the only one who feel that way, who have the potential, who have the talent, whatever talent it can be in whatever industry, and you cannot make it because, one, you don't know the people that they know that were able to carry them where they are now, or two, you don't have the opportunity to benefit from pretty privilege. And that is very sad. And I think it's, yes, it happened in the celebrity world a lot, but it also happened in every city, everywhere in the world. Like, everybody has a story where they did not have that job because the person who has it knows Pookie, knows Cuckoo inside the business, or because she's not that pretty and the other person is more pretty to look at, so she has a job other than you when you have more experience and more talent than that person. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and I've been through this when I worked in corporate America. I'll never forget. And this is why sometimes I tell people, if you want to expand and move on, sometimes you don't want to be the best in your position because it can, you know, it can almost hinder you. And I remember at one point I was doing collections, and I had been doing collections for like 2 years, and I was one of the top collectors. If I called your house, oh, you're going to pay these bills, okay? You are going to pay your car note when you get off the phone with me. So I was really good at my job, but after a while, you know, you want to move on. You know, that wasn't my dream job. And so there was a position open to do like repossessions and work with like loss prevention and things like that. And it was between me and this really pretty girl. Like, she was like, you know, face wise, she was gorgeous. Her makeup was always on point. Hair was always done. But her stats were nowhere near mine. She barely hit goal. You know, mediocre, really nice girl. But when it came to working, her work ethic was not where mine was. And I remember we went for the interview and everybody was like, T, you got this. You know, you put in work. You've been here. You know, you're always winning awards, this and that. And I lost the position. And I remember just being devastated. And then I remember people were telling me, like, you know, you only lost it because she's prettier, or because, you know, she's kind of like light, you know what I'm saying, racially ambiguous. And so I remember that was like the talk of the office, that this mediocre, not say mediocre in looks, but, you know, mediocre as far as work ethic, got the higher paying position and I got stuck in my position. And that was the first time it kind of, you know, was kind of seen to me in the corporate world that, yes, looks can get you in certain places, even when you're mediocre at your job, you know. And yeah, you could even attribute it to some colorism as well. But I remember I felt like just really defeatist. I was kind of upset, you know, because she, like, everybody said that, you know, even my manager was like, she definitely did not deserve the position over you. But what do? You still got to pay your bills and still come to work and have a smile on your face. But yeah, pretty privilege is definitely real. And to even go deeper, we got to understand that we have been conditioned, okay, to look at looks. From the time that we're children, we are conditioned to look at people based on how they look, even before we look at how they treat other people. Think about Disney. Most of the Disney princess characters are beautiful, from Ariel to Tiana to Belle from Beauty and the Beast. These are all beautiful characters. Now think about all of the protagonists. Think about all of the evil villains. they're ugly, they have hook noses, they have, you know, moles on their face. You know, they're not attractive. They're usually witches and evil characters. So ugliness and being less attractive is attached to being evil, being bad, you know, being jealous. So we've been conditioned from the time that we were children that in order to be pretty, your life will be better. Prince Charming will come and look for you if you're beautiful. If you look like the evil stepdaughters, nobody's checking for you. Remember in Cinderella? So that is the real, that is, you know, real. It's programming. And we can even take that to coming to America. Who remembers coming to America? Remember as children, Patrice, the darker skinned sister, was seen as less attractive. No, you know, they were willing to smash her, but nobody was willing to marry her and treat her like a princess. Everything was about Lisa McDowell, the beautiful older sister, you know? So even in that dynamic, we were being conditioned, you know? So it definitely goes deep. So what have you been through? Like, have you experienced pretty privilege? Like, have you been on one end of the spectrum or another, Marino?
I have once. It was, like I said, I've done many pageant contests, and I've done one time. And I kid you not, I've had, like, many experience in pageantry. Like, I've done it, I've won it. And when we were doing the interviews, I'm not trying to give, like, to pat myself on the back and to try and sound smarter. Everybody said to me that my answer was better. Everybody said to me that my answer was better. What I was saying sounded more smart and also was related to what the pageant was about. But I didn't even made it to the top five because everybody in the top five was, one, a different color, like skin color, and two, they were, quote unquote, according to me, more pretty than me. And I said according to me because some, like, beauty is in the eyes of the beholder. For some people, this person is prettier and that person is not, and et cetera, et cetera. We all have a guy that we look at him and we say, oh my God, he looks like, I don't know, Idris Elba, and somebody is looking at you like, girl, are you serious? It looks like Quasimodo. So beauty is in the eyes of the beholder, but to me, they were more prettier than me. They had longer hair, straight hair when I have kinky hair. They have the body type that I don't have. Like I always say to people, I'm shaped up the letter P. I have huge boobs and no ass. So they were like more pretty than me. So they were able to make it more further because they can sell those girls more than they can sell me in the long run. So I do believe that at that time, it was kind of linked to pretty privilege, according to me, because they couldn't do with me what they could achieve with them when it comes to the pageant world. Can I say one thing regarding what you said earlier? In the Disney cartoons also, I don't know if we can link this to a little bit of colorism, because I don't know if you noticed, every time it was related to like the evil character, they were always a different shade of like a different color than the person that who's the best person that they should go after, etc. For example, I forgot this cartoon, this name of the cartoon, but the girl who gave her voice to the evil witch so that she can like walk and be with the prince, the Little Mermaid, there you go. The Little Mermaid, the evil girl was a different skin color. Like there are so many cartoons that when it comes to the evil person, not only they are uglier, but they're also a different shade of color, which is like more dark than the other person who's supposed to be prettier. I don't know if you see that as well.
Yeah, I mean, look at Ursula. She was big and purple.
Big and purple.
Right. So yeah, they definitely do that. They definitely, you know, ingrain this in us from the time that we're children. So I'm going to go ahead and start bringing on some other calls. Please make sure that your microphone, I'm going to bring on the stage. Just mute your microphone until I say your name. So I'm going to start bringing a few people on here. I want to hear from everybody. I want to know your thoughts on what you guys think about Sweetie's performance, what you guys think about Lori Harvey. And if you yourself have gone through pretty privilege, are you the pretty one and people assume certain things about you? Or are you, you know, less attractive? And that's okay. But I just hate how society tries to act like, oh, it's all about what's in the heart that matters. And, oh, everybody's beautiful. No, not really. You know, because if that's the case, there wouldn't be a beauty algorithm on TikTok. Let's keep that real. There's a beauty algorithm that scores people by AI,
you know, on the level of their beauty, and that pushes them through the algorithm. And if you're less attractive, or if you have a scar, if you look a certain way that the beauty algorithm doesn't deem as attractive, then you don't, you know, your videos get buried.
TikTok does have an algorithm to evaluate how pretty you are. If you spend enough time on the Chinese deep web, you can find ByteDance documentation like this. Google Translate tells us that they are looking at the beauty of the hottest, ugliest, and average person in your video. The algorithm looks at 86 key points on your face to determine your beauty. The authors have a GitHub, which I cloned, and then I had to fix a bunch of issues, but I eventually got it working. The algorithm says I'm a 3.
So let's keep that real. I want to hear real discussions from people. So let me go ahead and let's start with Ashley Chanel. Go ahead and unmute your microphone.
Hey.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good. So I live in Los Angeles, California, and I definitely believe in pretty privilege, because when I first moved here, being like an influencer, I lived with a roommate that was my best friend and also an influencer. And she had other privileges, let's just say she was of another race. But as far as like the show we were both on, she was always considered like prettier, more popular, and things of that nature. And it didn't really affect me until, because she's a friend, I'm not looking at her in an envious way or anything, but it didn't really affect me until I realized that, like, even my own culture, like people of my own culture, Black men, would receive her differently in comparison to me. And so when it came to like invitations, things as far as like access went, she would get all of these things before me. And I would just be like, wait, how come, like, I was there? How come I didn't get that? Or how come? And so it was like always just so weird to me. And then I had to have like a conversation about it with my best friend. And I was like, you know, it could be white privilege, but I don't think it's that. And then we started talking about pretty privilege. So this is like a really interesting conversation, because it really happens a lot in Los Angeles, California. Like, it happens so much. And especially with pageants, of course, because I kind of feel like that's the concept of pageants. But like in the real world, in like work politics, it happens all the time. And I feel like it sucks for the people that like work very hard or are very smart. And, you know, we just get overlooked because we don't have the looks that people want us to have, or we just don't have the complexion or things of that nature that America brands as beautiful. So it does suck, but, and I think it affects everyone, but I just feel like the more your confidence outweighs like how people view pretty, the more, you know, people will be adamant about like falling in love with your spirit, your personality, your confidence, and things of that nature outside of just your beauty.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And being someone who also lived in LA before, LA can definitely take a toll on your self-esteem.
Yo, what's up?
Hey, Tea Sippers. To listen to the rest of this podcast, please go to Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Play, Stitcher, TunedIn, or AnchorFM.com, which is a free podcasting site. Thank you guys so much for the support, and stay tuned for the next video.